Okay, honorable senators, these are the results. Abstentions, 1. Nays, 12. Ayes, 52. Honorable senators.
A bill for an act to amend the constitution by popular initiative.
Okay, the ayes have it. Okay, this is the communication that I want to give now before the Committee of the Whole, which will sit at 2:30, on whether a bill to amend the Constitution pursuant to Article 257 of the Constitution can be amended. Honorable Senators, as you are aware, in the course of the debate on the Constitution of Kenya Amendment Bill 2020, I have been variously urged by a number of senators to make a ruling on a number of matters which they consider to be pertinent for purposes of guiding the Senate in its disposal of the bill. These requests have come from, among others, Senators Samson Cherargei, Sakaja Johnson, Mutula Kilonzo Jr., and Moses Wetangula. Senator Mutula Kilonzo Jr., MP, in particular, during the morning sitting of Thursday, 6 May 2021, went so far as to give some advice to the Speaker on the matters that should be contained in such ruling and the authorities that should be cited. It is an invitation which, as a Speaker of the Senate, I promptly declined. At the time, I guided the Senate that the questions on which I was being requested to rule were premature and anticipatory as they had not ripened for determination. Honorable Senators, as you are aware, the Constitution of Kenya Amendment Bill 2020 was introduced in Parliament and read a first time in the National Assembly and the Senate on 4th March 2021, pursuant to Articles 257(7) of the Constitution. Pursuant to Standing Order Number 141 and 145 of the Senate Standing Orders, the bill was referred to the Standing Committee on Justice, Legal Affairs and Human Rights for consideration. The Standing Committee was mandated to consider the bill jointly with the Departmental Committee on Justice and Legal Affairs of the National Assembly. The committees tabled a joint report on Wednesday, 28th April 2021 in both Houses of Parliament. As I have indicated, in the course of debate, the second reading questions arose as to whether a bill to amend the Constitution introduced by a popular initiative such as the one before us can be amended and resultantly, whether therefore amendments can be proposed and admitted by the Speaker for consideration by the Senate at the Committee of the Whole. The second issue on which I was requested to rule was whether errors of form in the bill could be corrected, and if so, the stage at which this could be done. Honorable Senators, I am of the view, having considered all circumstances, that these two questions, while they are noted, while they are novel, insofar as the consideration of a Constitution of Kenya Amendment Bill by popular initiative is unprecedented in the Senate, they are not so complex as to require the kind of detailed or lengthy ruling that I was invited to pronounce. Honorable Senators, as you further aware, the Constitution of Kenya Amendment Bill 2020 was prepared and processed pursuant to Article 257 of the Constitution as a bill to amend the Constitution by a way of popular initiative. With regard to the consideration of the bill by Parliament, Article 257, 7, 8, 9, 10 of the Constitution provides as follows, and I quote, "If a draft bill has been approved by a majority of the county assemblies, it shall be introduced in Parliament without delay. B. A bill under this article is passed by Parliament if supported by a majority of the members of each House. C. If Parliament passes the bill, it shall be submitted to the President for assent in accordance with Article 256, 4, and 5. 10. If either House of Parliament fails to pass the bill or the bill relates to a matter specified in Article 255, 1, the proposed amendment shall be subjected to the people in a referendum. From the foregoing, the questions raised by the Honorable Senators emanate from the fact that Article 257 of the Constitution, which is the only article of the Constitution governing the amendment of the Constitution by a popular initiative, does not expressly pronounce itself on whether Parliament, in considering the bill, may or may not amend it. This position is markedly different from the position accrued by the former constitution of Kenya, which was hence immediately preceded the promulgation of the Constitution of Kenya 2010. This former constitution provided Article 47(4) as follows: when a bill for an act of Parliament to alter this constitution has been introduced into the National Assembly, no alteration shall be made in it before it is presented to the President for assent, except alterations which are certified by the Speaker to be necessary because of the time that has elapsed and since the bill was first introduced into the Assembly. No corresponding provision was imported into the Constitution of Kenya 2010 in respect of constitutional amendment by popular initiative, and that matter even in respect of amendments by parliamentary initiative. Honorable Senators, it's noteworthy that when considering this question, the joint sittings of the National Assembly Departmental Committee on Justice and Legal Affairs and the Senate Standing Committee on Justice and Legal Affairs and Human Rights found that Article 94 of the Constitution vests the legislative authority of the Republic in Parliament and that Parliament has the mandate to take any legislative action in appropriate circumstances required to ensure that a constitutional amendment initiated under Article 257 of the Constitution achieves the objectives so as to prevent the sovereignty of the people as guaranteed under Article 1 of the Constitution. This finding is profound. It is a recognition that while Parliament, pursuant to Article 94(3) of the Constitution, represents the will of the people and exercises their sovereignty, the extent of Parliament's powers is not unlimited. Represents that the will of the people and exercises their will, sovereignty, the extent of Parliament's powers is not unlimited. Parliament, like all other state organs, is bound by the national values and principles of governance under Article 10 of the Constitution when applying or interpreting the Constitution or enacting, applying or interpreting any law. The Constitution itself has also provided for the manner of its interpretation at Article 259, Clause 1, whereof provides that the Constitution shall be interpreted in a manner that A, promotes its purposes, values, and principles, 2, advances the rule of law and the human rights and fundamental freedoms in the Bill of Rights, C, permits the development of the law, and D, contributes to good governance. Honorable Senators, a bill to amend the Constitution by way of popular initiative is one that emanates from members of the public and is required to be supported by at least 1 million registered voters. The bill represents the initiatives of the promoters regarding provisions which they wish to amend in order to address specific concerns or issues in the Constitution. This is a route taken by citizens who are fully aware and have foregone the route of seeking constitutional amendments by a parliamentary initiative. It is a route taken by citizens who recognize that pursuant to Article 1 of the Constitution, all sovereign power belongs to the people directly or through their democratically elected representatives. I am persuaded that a proper construction of the Constitution leads us to the conclusion that Parliament's delegated power to exercise the sovereignty of the people by representing their will does not and cannot extend to subverting, altering, or substituting that will with its own wisdom, whether the people have unequivocally expressed themselves. Honorable Senator, subjecting a bill to amend the Constitution by a way of popular initiative to amend by the Senate risks altering or substituting the intentions of the promoters of the bill with those of the Senate, and hence the overall output of the process may be a bill containing provisions that were neither contemplated nor designed by its promoters. This is particularly so because If the Senate can amend one clause of the bill, it can amend two clauses of the bill. And if the Senate can amend two clauses of the bill, then it can amend all the clauses of the bill, resulting in a bill that is unrecognizable from the one that was submitted to the Senate by its promoters. Can such a resulting bill still be said to be a bill by a popular initiative? Honorable Senators, in light of the foregoing and supported by the findings of the committees, there is need to protect the sovereign will of the people. Indeed, the committees of the two houses, which consider this bill, found at paragraph 364 that pursuant to Article 257(10) of the Constitution, Parliament cannot replace or usurp the people's views on a particular, on a popular initiative with its own, and that the ultimate authority regarding a popular initiative bill rests with the people. I agree. I therefore rule, in respect to the specific questions, ask that an amendment may be made to the provisions of a bill to amend the Constitution by way of a popular initiative in the Senate. The Senate has the option of either passing or rejecting the bill in total in accordance with Article 257(8) of the Constitution. Following from these findings, I decline to approve the notices of proposed amendments to the bill at the committee stage submitted to my office by Senator for Murang'a County, Senator Irungu Kang'ata, MP, Senator for Kitui County, Senator Enoch Wambua, MP, the nominated Senator, Senator Millicent Omanga, MP, and the Senator for Nandi County, Senator Samson Cherargei. The question then arises whether the Senate still proceeds to the Committee of the Whole on the BBI, on the bill, and if so, the manner in which the committee stage is to be transacted. The Committee of the Whole is a mandatory stage for the constitution of any bill. A bill for an amendment of the Constitution by popular initiative is no exception. The committee stage is the forum at which the Senate is able to consider the bill clause by clause in a detailed manner. As senators are aware, the procedure in the Committee of the Whole is less rigid than that of the Senate in plenary and permits any senator to speak to any clause, including speaking more than once to a question proposed. The only difference will be that the deliberations in the Committee of the Whole, including contributions by individual senators, can only be geared towards the acceptance or rejection of the bill as a whole. All the clauses and the schedules will accordingly be read out and proposed as is standard procedure in the Committee of the Whole, but only one question will be put, which shall be that the clauses, the schedules, and the title be part of the bill. Senators will then be expected to vote either yes or no, or abstain. The bill is a whole and not any particular clause or part of the bill on its own. Honorable Senators, one final matter remains, which is the question whether formal errors may be corrected, and if so, the manner of such correction. This matter is to be approached cautiously because the device of correction must not be subfuge for substantive amendments to the bill through the back door. Indeed, on this, the committees found that Parliament's legislative action includes correcting any errors of form or typographical errors that do not go to the substance of the bill and that bring drafting harmony to the bill. That's paragraph 365. Standing order number 162 provides for the custody of the bills and process after passage of a bill, although, as I have indicated earlier on this communication, no specific provisions exist in our standing orders on the processing of a constitutional amendment by a popular initiative. I am of the view and I rule that invoking Articles 10 and 259 of the Constitution and applying standing order number 1, requiring the Speaker to decide all matters that are not expressly provided for by the standing orders, it is appropriate that the Speakers of Parliament correct formal errors or oversights without changing the substance of the bill before certification of the bill and submission to the President. This would apply to those types of errors which the committees found as inadvertent errors in the copies of the bill which were typographical in nature and which did not affect the substance of the bill. The Senate is accordingly guided. I thank you.
What's your point of order, Senator Mutula Jr.?
Mr. Speaker, before you finish your communication, you had mentioned something about the third reading. Mr. Speaker, I wish we could stop the sun, we can't. I wish you could stop the lunch hour, we can't, but we are ready to vote for the third reading. I'm proposing to you, understanding order number 31 and 1, that you call the third reading committee of the whole so that we can vote and leave this chamber after finishing this business together, Mr. Speaker. Owing to its momentous position and what we are doing today, Mr. Speaker, I don't see the reason why we should take a lunch break before we finish the vote, Mr. Speaker, and I believe, Mr. Speaker, you can use your discretion to do so, so that we can finish this business. When we come in the afternoon, Mr. Speaker, we resume with the business that is in the order paper and related to the constitutional amendment bill. Thank you.